Thanks a lot for keeping a date with us on the program Politics Today on Independent Television and Radio. My name is Sonny Duke Okosie, your host on the program. So amazing how COVID-19 has taken over virtually, literally everything all across the world. Naturally, on a day like this, we'll be talking about who is strategizing or planning, or who is manipulating, or who is politicking or politicking ahead of 2023 or 2020, as in the case of Edo State. But that time is no longer there. We need to see how we can leverage on the time that we have to disseminate information as much as we can, so everyone can take action and really contain COVID-19. My name is Sonny Duke Okosun, your host on the show. It's no longer news that a total of 210 cases have been confirmed in Nigeria, 25 discharged, and 4 deaths recorded so far from COVID-19 pandemic. And it looks like, if you look at those three categorizations that I just gave, a little attention is normally given to one of them, which is the number of people that have actually recovered from the pandemic, using Nigeria as a case study. That will be a start-up point on our conversations today. Then in addition, it looks like now we're talking about lockdown, whether partial or total. The greatest concern is how people will survive in the face of lockdown. We have a video we'll show you. It came from Lagos State. Someone complaining about the package given to him for staying indoors, and the guy was complaining bitterly. Also, in our next neighbor here, talking about Delta State, a soldier has been reportedly killed, allegedly killed. A civilian has also been killed as a result of a clash between soldiers and civilians over lockdown in that state. Is lockdown the answer? And the big question is, with the lockdown, what are the palliatives? What is the welfare package put together? We've seen some of the reports coming from other climes, what has been done just to ensure that everyone truly stays indoor, and then their needs are met, their bills are paid. Let me welcome our panelists. From my extreme left is Comrade Austin Osakwe, is Executive Director of Foundation for Good Governance and Social Change. Is also a member of the Edo State COVID-19 Task Force. Comrade, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much. Good morning, viewers and listeners on radio.
We have with us in the studio Pastor Greg Iyayi, is also a lawyer, I guess, yeah? Thank you so much for joining us, Pastor Greg.
Thank you.
Okay, we have with us in the studio Chief A.B. Thomas, a constitutional lawyer, a public affairs commentator. Pastor A.B. Thomas, many thanks for joining us on the program.
Thank you very much for having me here.
Okay, let me start right away with Comrade Austin Osakwe. I looked at the numbers, from the number of confirmed cases to the number of those discharged, and then to the number of deaths. Why is it that we're not focusing on the number of those recovered? So at least people can have a sense that this is not a death sentence. After all, if 25 people can recover, God forbid the person gets the virus, there's a strong possibility, maybe 75% chance, such a person could also recover. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think that some emphasis has been placed on the recovery, because that's what gives hope. In fact, until yesterday, people were beginning to wonder whether it is possible for a black man to die from the coronavirus pandemic. We now know that it is possible for people to die. However, the number of recoveries on a daily basis is so encouraging. And then we also know now that before yesterday, the 2 deaths that were recorded were of persons who had underlying sicknesses. And that has been proven globally, that the large number of deaths, the larger number of deaths are for elderly and those who have some sicknesses.
Okay.
So I agree entirely. We must begin to focus on these recoveries, so that we know that, yes, when you have it, it's not a death sentence. But far and beyond that is the reality that our people must accept. Everywhere you go, you still hear the argument. 3 arguments, actually. There is the extreme, those who say it's a scam, that it doesn't exist, all of this that we are hearing is a scam. How that can be, how they can sustain that argument, is troubling. Mm. Because as I speak to you, globally, over 56,000 people have lost their lives. The number of those infected is in excess of 1,100,000+.
Yeah.
And yet some people feel that it's a scam. There's a second level. Those who believe that this one can only affect the high and mighty, the rich, the big time politicians, those big names out there. But they forget that the fact that two or three governors come out to say we are positive, and the fact that we have mentioned one or two names of people who are highly placed who have it, does not remove the fact that we are over 200 cases. Mm. And the majority of those cases, we don't know their identities.
Yeah.
Who tells them that these are not really people like us, mm-hmm. what we call the proverbial common man? And then you have the third scenario. Those who say, yes, we agree it is there, but hunger is worse. So don't let the cure become worse than the ailment. Is there? No doubt about that. But we have pineapple. We mix it with the other one, lemon, and add garlic. That can do it. We have, they understand there is alcohol. There's a case of somebody who soaked himself in alcohol, the one the Niger Delta referred to as kankan. You know, so you have this one.
So it doesn't
really matter.
Yeah.
We can do a few things and then that's all.
Yeah.
But we need to underline the fact that this thing is not just there, it is real, and it is killing, and killing in thousands. We have been lucky in Nigeria for two reasons. One, we appear to have responded early.
Mm-hmm.
Not early enough, because if we had closed the borders
early enough
and prevented aircraft from bringing people
perhaps
would have had a zero occurrence.
Yeah, yeah.
But we still acted, closed down the border. So our number is limited.
Okay.
And there is contact tracing that is going on.
Yeah.
The second thing is that it would appear that there is a trend. The numbers that we have are of two categories, according to the NCDC and the World Health Organization. You have those who came into Nigeria from outside. That's one category. The second category are those who made contacts
with those who came into Nigeria.
So the trick really is, first, the ability to continue and sustain contact tracing across the country. And then the second thing is for people to willingly come out
to test
and say, look, I am feeling this way. Or I have made contact with somebody who has now become infected.
I think that's the biggest challenge,
yes,
really, for now. Well, I'll come back to you in a moment. Comrade, I'll come back to you. Let me bring Pastor Greg Iyaye in here. The lockdown has been interpreted differently. You from the church, there is also an interpretation. And that has been overtaken by event based on the press conference given by the camp chairman of the state, Bishop Orinam Oyonude Kore. How is the church taking this? What are your thoughts?
Well, the way we look at it is that generally the government has said that gatherings can take place, but not more than 20. And that no more than 20, there should be social distancing. We agree with that. And we believe that should be the position for now. Total lockdown of churches has some very serious implications. Number one, are you infringing on the rights of the citizen to worship? And worship in an atmosphere that is regulated. Because some churches have even done self-regulation. And I also want us to know that within these churches, there are doctors, there are health officials, there are widely educated people who, even without the government, have been doing some form of enlightenment education and making sure, because nobody would like the church members to die.
Mm.
If I'm a doctor and I'm in a congregation, like in our church, the health officials, even before the government said anything, quickly did something, told us what to do, things to put in place, and that was it. So I would like us to respect, even when we are trying to give solution, like the comrade has said, the cure should not become worse than the ailment. Mm. Let us, the mega churches, I know they have a problem, crowd control.
Yeah.
But there are some churches that are not even up to 20. Mm. Let's allow them to hold their services and respect social distancing. Mm. Because at the end of the day, we need both the medical solution and also the spiritual solution. And I believe every genuine believer is praying that this COVID-19 should be solved. So let's give them the opportunity to pray.
Okay. All right, thank you very much. Pastor Ebifemos, I wanted to, key us on the most disturbing complaints that we've had in recent time as it relates to COVID-19. Now, with the lockdown, what next? What are we going to eat? What are we going to feed on? What are the palliatives? What's the welfare package put together? That seems not to be coming in. And interestingly, we've heard of billions and billions and billions coming in form of donations. The Jimovias, the Otedola, the Aliko Dangote, the Tony Elumelu, many others. And some have, in their own way, come up with how these monies can actually go around just to ensure that everybody has a piece of the action and they really stay at home and avoid, bridging social distancing. What are your thoughts?
Well, Nigeria had enough time to prepare for this COVID-19. It's like 2019. China is now a destination for Nigerians who travel a lot. And we ought to know that when these things were going on in China, some of our citizens would travel there and come back infected. So we had the opportunity to prepare. Now, asking us to lock down without the government doing anything in advance to prepare for the lockdown, it is anachronistic, it's archaic, it shows bad governance. Why am I saying this? Like I said, we knew Nigerians are always traveling. Nigerians go to China to buy wares, they sell Nigeria here, go to Mission Road, Dawson. All the furniture you find there, electronics are for China, Japan, everything. We knew all this. We knew that Nigerians are going to Spain. Will Nigerians go to England? Will Nigerians go to Italy? So we have our time to prepare. So when we ask for lockdown, we will be able to provide what we keep people indoors. That we didn't do. Now you are asking me to stay indoors. The courts are closed. I have no opportunity of going to the courts to end my daily bread. The statistics is this. Only 8% of Nigerians are government paid workers. Only 8%. Then 12% are corporate paid workers. Then the remaining 80% are self daily earners. Whether you are a doctor, you are a lawyer, once you are on your own, you are a daily paid person.
Yes, yes.
I am on daily paid category.
Yes.
You ask me to stay indoors. I cannot go to court. Clients cannot come to me. The courts are locked. You want me to feed my family. How do I do it? Before the lockdown, no notice was given. It came suddenly because government was not prepared. This is how you now see that all successive governments in Nigeria, they have never been prepared for anything. It is now showing that all the sensors we have been spending money on are all fake. Because if we have accurate number of people that we are asking to lock down, we would have been able to know
yes.
the number of people we are going to feed, I don't go out. I have no food. I have no money. I have no water. I have no electricity. Then I now have only two choices. Stay indoors and die of hunger, or go outside and die of coronavirus. After I stay indoors, in compliance with the order of the government, and die of hunger, or my second option, disobey the government, go out, go and contact coronavirus, and die of coronavirus. I must choose one. I have no third choice, because there is nothing for me. Now, I had the opportunity of watching people in Agege being given poultry cellophane bag. One of the landlords was so angry. The man was asking, is this what you mean, that we should comply with government order, that we should all stay indoors with cellophane bag that only one of my sons can eat? And this is for me, my two wives, and my eight children. How do you do that? It's wicked. Yes, I am not against lockdown, for God's sake.
Okay.
It is the global solution to reduce the epidemic.
The spread, yeah.
And social distancing is another way of reducing the spread.
Yes.
But we know, we Nigerians, we don't stay in one place. We should have been prepared in advance.
Okay.
Now, having not done that, having given me the option to either die inside my house of hunger, the people were complaining again. I was watching them on it. Now, there were many of them had sheds. They said there was no lights inside. And in their house, they said they have 60 people in the house. This is Lagos. About 20 used to leave before 6 o'clock in the morning, they go to work. About 20 used to go out in the afternoon to go and hustle, like selling pure water, selling things along the road. About 20 used to go out at night. But now, the entire 60 were indoors. And they have two toilets, one for Obini, one for Okuri. That is, one for male, one for female. So everybody now, they have to queue. To go to toilet, you queue. To go to bath, you queue. And they never envisage in their life that they will all be at home
at the same time.
What is government doing about this?
Okay, let me bring Comrade Austin Osakwe in here. But just to reflect on something you said a while ago by Sebi Thomas, to say that all censuses done in the past were fake, I think that would be correct. Because I know some research work still would cite the 2006 census as a reference point. I'm hoping that in the days to come, a more authentic, accurate census of what the population of Nigeria is currently will be done, and then we can have something that we can quote more accurately. But to say that the census is done before or done in the past were fake, that would not be correct. Let me come to you, Comrade Austin. Yes, it is the hunger aspect of it, the welfare aspect of it. In US, Canada, Italy, and the rest of them, we heard of the billions. In some cases, you don't pay house rent. A whole lot of packages. Why is this difficult in Nigeria? And then, by the way, I heard the secretary to the government of the Federation saying that, look, all these billions that these guys are saying they've donated, government is yet to receive them. Comrade.
Now, Leonard Council has very eloquently painted the picture nationally. But I think that charity begins at home. And I have the privilege of being a member of the response team at the Edo State level.
Okay.
So I can tell you what is on ground in Edo. First, to mention that what we have in Edo is a partial lockdown, not total.
Yes. Yeah.
Government said very clearly that markets can open to the extent that they are coming to sell foodstuffs, medicaments, and other necessities. Others, please stay at home. What that means is that if markets are open to sell foodstuffs, it's people who are going to buy. So people can actually leave their homes, buy, and go back to their homes. There are also very essential one-man jobs, self-employed things that are going on all over the place, as long as they do not attract crowds. Vulcanizers are working, so that when you drive, you can fix your mechanic workshops. A lot of them are open. All of these small things, small and medium-scale enterprises, a lot of them are open. However, any business that we need to gather people above 20 in number, they are encouraged to stay back at home. So this is a partial lockdown. For the church, sir, I don't want to dwell so much on that. You have mentioned it.
Yes.
20. But the problem has been that when you provide a window for a church to hold service of no more than 20, what you find, and that has been the situation, is that people take that for granted. We have seen, look, enforcement people have gone to close churches that had over 100 people. As I speak to you last night, we have gotten reports of several all-night sessions that gathered a lot of people together. So what I think the church leadership needs to do is to drive it home to their members.
Yes.
That look, nobody is asking you not to worship your God, but also consider that there are implications.
Yeah.
So if it is not more than 20 at a time, for God's sake, observing the social distance rule, no problem.
That's true.
Now, what is in place? You talked about hunger. The reality is what Leonard, Council painted. The reality is that whereas it is possible to argue for a lockdown, we now know that a total lockdown is not possible in Nigeria. And the evidence for that is very clear. After 24 hours of lockdown in Lagos and Abuja, the federal government itself came out and relaxed it. Otherwise, you are going to have riots. You are going to have people dying. You are going to have people resisting. What happened in Warri, where a military man shot a civilian and sparked off a response from the civilians and killed the soldier?
Yes.
The story I got was that the fellow had attempted to take his child for treatment or something. Even if he was going to look for food, that is the reality. The argument that you cannot have a total lockdown is that majority of people today, whether you like it or not, the food they will eat tomorrow, they look for it today. Only few can afford to stock their homes. And if you lock down for 2 weeks, which is the incubation period, you are going to have serious situation in your hands. So what is present in Edo, the approach of the response at the Edo level is that number one, for now we can't have a total lockdown because of the implications I have just painted.
Yeah.
However, the isolation centers, some are ready, others are ongoing. Treatment centers are there. Nigeria has been lucky that we have been having mild cases. But when there are severe cases, there are also ICU sessions for very severe cases. That is there. And I think that the media tour that was done saw all of this. And I have advised government that all of this should be put in the media, should be put in the public space, so that people will see government's level of readiness. Government also is talking about a food bank, which contributions are in. And let's get this clear. If we are relying on government to do this alone,
it is not possible. Yes.
But government can chart a course. Government can mobilize the people, galvanize them to embrace what the response regime is. Government must enter into its resources and bring out money and put down. If you ask me to make contribution as a private person, as a business person, no matter how much I have, if I have not seen that government has put something there, I'm not going to put one naira. Because it is the responsibility of government. And at the level of Edo State, a food bank is set up to accommodate. When we use the word vulnerable, it's another tricky thing. Chief, we know Chief. I was going to embrace him just now and give him a small punch because he's my other brother. When he started saying, these are not the vulnerable. They are not the ones we are talking about. What Chief will eat next year is ready now. Forget it. So when we are talking about vulnerable, we also need to identify who the vulnerables are. Where are they? Like he said, and I'm likely to go with him when you mentioned 200 and something sensor. Because we don't have another one, that's why we are using that one. Is it realistic?
No, it's not.
There are several things that the committee has thought about. For instance, if we look at MTN, Glo and Airtel, and we ask for a record of purchases of recharge card, The person who purchases 10,000 a day and the one who manages to buy 100 naira for 3 days, there's a gap.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's one. The UBE program that has public schools and their parents. I understand that the UBE has a record of all the parents of the children in all public
enrolled.
So that creates a database.
That's a database. These are some of the things that government is hoping to latch on.
Okay.
To identify where the vulnerables are.
And then address them?
Address them. And then medicaments. For instance, I saw ventilators. Government is saying now that they have up to 28. For God's sake, let the media team of government conduct stakeholders round to see, because it also helps to engender confidence in
the system. Yeah.
The government has put this in place, has put this in place. These are the places. And the citizens are now able to also educate themselves and encourage others.
Okay.
And by the way, there is an app. You know, one of the problems that has come up is the level of fake news. People just sit down, design
something that will create tension. We'll talk about it.
This committee has designed an app that you can key into, download it, and get
daily updates.
Hourly updates.
Okay.
You know the number, you know the one coming, and then there are lines. Apart from the dedicated lines at the national level, Edo State has 3 lines.
All right.
Which will be on air.
Yes, we have those lines. We have those lines on our scroll bar, so you can take those numbers down so you can call, make inquiries, and then report any incident. Now, let me come to Bryce Ibi Thomas. I'll come to you, Pastor Greg.
Yes.
Several billions have been donated. The secretary to the government or the federation is saying, we're here to get this money. I've had people, you know, create all kinds of formulas as to how these monies can be shared. I mean, so that people like you, who have been taken out of, you know, chambers for a while, can get a chunk
three
of it.
3 weeks. And all of us are all home.
So let me get your take on that.
Yes, straight away. Usakwe started it by saying, if he wants to donate money and he can't see what government has written,
yes,
he will not put his stamp on. These people are not fools. They know that this present government at the center.
No, let's not go on that path.
All right. I am telling you.
Yes.
If these people are not saying billion.
And we are not seeing the money.
Yes, because the people don't have confidence. If you tell lies all the time, and the people don't see what you are doing, when the kudos to Lagos State government, they released money immediately. The first man, the Italian man, was identified as the index
case.
Lagos State government released money without going to Asorok. That is the foundation of a proper federation. Now, federal government did not release anything at that immediate point. The president did not address the nation at that immediate point. You are asking me to donate 1 billion or donate anything. No amount is too small. I will not donate. Even if I announce the donation, I want to know how that money will get to the people who actually needs it. Now, coming back to your question, I have done the calculation. As at 30 billion that was donated, 11 came from NNPC, Dangote, Oyetola, and others, were 1 billion each. I arrived at 30 billion. Assuming our population is 200 million, assuming every Nigerian is entitled to about 160,000 naira per person. So if you and your wife are together, that's 320,000. You cannot send this thing to a central pool called Presidential Task Force. We are Nigerians. I have said it at different fora. Our middle names ought to be corruption. Like you say, Abayomi, corruption, Thomas. Every Nigerian is looking, look at what's going on. Go to the market. Every product, the price has gone up. Nigerians look for where to profit, where they did not sow.
Yes.
And putting these people there as members of the Presidential Task Force, many of them are already thinking how much they can take to Switzerland, how much they can used in building houses. It cannot be all of them. But you see, I will not donate my 1 billion when I'm not sure where the money is going to.
Yeah.
But if you have said, we are going to give this money directly to Nigerians who are encouraged to lock down, to stay indoors, people will come out, more people will come out.
Okay.
In America, let me give you what happened.
Mm.
In America, the government decided to give $1,000 to every family. And that is equal to 380,000 naira every 2 weeks. It is apart from all assorted food, beverages, and what, of course, they don't need to supply water. They have water. They did this, and today they are still doing it. And it has encouraged Bill Gates, Buffett, and others to pump in more money. And that is why many Americans are willing to stay indoors.
Mm.
If I cannot see the money people are donating, and you're asking me to stay indoors, I will ask myself, what will I eat?
Okay.
But when this money is coming out,
yeah,
and you don't see it to federal government presenters force, where I cannot locate anything. And I can tell you straight away, the young man you mentioned in Wori, he was taking his child for medical treatment. In America, no such thing was going on. And I mention America because America does not have the level of poverty that we have in Nigeria. So we are supposed to be more prepared than America. If it's America, all you do is to die 111.
Yes.
Then
and the emergency team will come.
Yes, the emergency team will come.
Yeah.
Pick him.
And keep that child indoors. There will be no need for that to go out to die.
Okay, let me pursue by Sabi Thomas. In a moment, our studio lines will be open, so you can also call and be part of the conversation. But let me come to Pastor Greg.
Yes.
In your opinion,
yes,
we're hoping this will come to an end. But the question has always been, will the world ever remain the same after COVID-19, even though we can't tell when this will come to an end? Yes.
I believe the world will never be the same. And the reason is this. Those countries where this virus has devastated, some families are devastated, economies are devastated, even the political system devastated. So the world cannot be the same. And also too, for those who are suspicious, strongly suspicious that a particular country might have been responsible for this, they are going to be on their toes, and they are going to be sleeping with one eye. Mm. And their relationship with them is never going to be the same. So the seed of suspicion and ill will that will be sown. I'll give you an example. Spain imported 50,000 test kits from a particular country.
From China.
China. All of them failed. So you can see the death rates in Spain, because if people are not tested, they might have this disease and be going around and spreading it. So the tension, the ill will, the pressure that has been created, you know, we don't live in history. Some people will say it's all history, but it is wrong to forget the lessons of history. And I don't think many countries are going to forget the lessons of history in a hurry.
Okay, comrade, China seems to be at the center of it all. President Donald Trump will always say it's a Chinese virus, a Chinese disease. What do you make of the semi-growing public perception of China in the face of all of this?
Well, the reality is that it started in China. And some people went ahead to say that they have seen videos of Chinese eating live rats, toad, snake. They eat all kinds of things. So that tended to add up. But you see, there's huge global politics around where it started from. There's also a conspiracy theory that America may have originated it, sent it to China to bring the Chinese economy down, that the Chinese have been pursuing America to overtake them as the biggest economic power. So all of those are on. But you see, eventually, the truth or something close to the truth will come out. But that shouldn't be our concern now. It is those who survive that will take part in the discussion later of that politics.
Yeah.
For now, it is what should be our response. And I am very particular about how the people need to go about this. Whether we like it or not, it's growing. Yesterday it was less than 200, today it's more than 200 in Nigeria. And even the official sources are telling us that this is just the beginning. Yeah. So we have to be ready. And I'm concerned about our immediate environment. Well, Edo is lucky for one thing now.
Yes.
Lagos has shut their borders. Ondo, as I yesterday, shut their borders. So from Edo now, you can't go beyond
Ore. Delta has shut their borders.
Delta has shut their borders. So we can't go beyond the you know, Edo boundary with Delta
here.
Hologo. So we already caged in. So we are not talking about locking borders.
Yes.
But there's no total shutdown in Edo. So it's how do we manage this partial shutdown? Number one is that people need to believe that this pandemic is real and that people are getting infected on a daily basis. Yes. Number two is that people need to observe social distancing. Social distancing simply means put 1 meter between yourself and the next person.
1 meter is just about three feet.
Which is not asking for
much.
Yeah. We are doing some mini social distancing. This wasn't the arrangement.
It wasn't.
It wasn't. Then, it was when you came that we are saying, distancing. Pardon me, sir. So, there are face masks. Please use them. The good thing they do is that, apart from government, individuals are distributing things.
Peace, man.
And we must key into all of this. Yes. I don't care who it is coming from. As long as it is good, let's accept them.
Yeah. Let's so, commend it to you.
Exactly. So, businesses, offices are now putting flowing water outside their offices and homes. You wash your hands with soap.
You sanitize
and then you sanitize your hands. So, we follow all this. And then, please, it is not for nothing that governors, government said from level 1 to 12, work from home. All right? Even if you have to go out, do the essentials and come back in. It's not a total lockdown. Mm. But as much as possible, let us change our attitude. Let's know that something has happened and things cannot be the same again. Number three is the fact that we must key into the arrangements that government says it has put in place. And we need to know what these arrangements are so we can be asking questions. At the level of medical or healthcare, what arrangement is in place? If government says there are testing centers, where are they? Mm. If government says there are isolation centers, some already done, some ongoing, where are they?
Mm.
It is not by criminalizing, by creating all kinds of unfounded things that we're going to help ourselves. Number four is that good neighborliness is important at this point. If I know, because you see, this thing is like it's like somebody coughing in your neighborhood in the night. You won't sleep. To say that you are comfortable and you won't help the next person, you are only preparing the way for you to be infected. So if we have people who lack and we have, let's assist them. If we have people who are ignorant, let's enlighten them. In doing all of this, we are getting there. And then, of course, finally, it is important to point out that in Lagos, they have gone beyond where they were yesterday. Edo has gone beyond where we were yesterday, and it is going to go on.
So there's some level of progression.
There is progression.
Okay.
And then there is hope, too, that there have been more of mild cases. There are recoveries. As at yesterday, over 25 had been discharged, which means people are contacting the thing, and they are becoming liberated from it. They are being cured of it.
Okay, let's.
So we need to key into all of this.
Let's just before we open our studio line, so we can take your calls. Number is 052-290-573. That's the studio number. That number, and then you can contribute to the discussion today on COVID-19 pandemic. What are the palliatives? That's a question that we are asking. And we're hoping that in the days to come, we'll get to feel the impact of what is being done in terms of helping to assuage the feelings of the people that have been asked to stay, I know, particularly those in business. All right, Barrister Ebi Thomas. Yeah. On a final note, because one of my colleagues did a report. She went to town to find out people's understanding of some of the basic concepts that are associated with COVID-19. One of them, quarantine. The other, social distancing. Goodness me. The responses were horrible. Horrible. I mean, you just find people saying, I don't even know what they're talking about. I mean, so what do you make of this? On the part of ITV Radio, for the past, as far as I can remember, we have been on this, talking about it every day. We have jingles we have produced as a station or on television. But I know that in the days of yore, we had an organization or an agency of government called Orientation Agency, still in existence.
Yes.
When they were MAMSA, we knew what they did with the Better Life Women kind of thing. Yeah. So I don't know what you make of this.
Yes.
Yeah.
I start from your last sentence. Mm. That shows the failure of government. No more MAMSA. No more National Orientation Agency. The Ministry of Information is not disseminating any information. Now, your TV you're talking about, the TV depends on availability of electricity.
And it's not there.
And it is not there. When MAMSA was there, they put this on a public address system out of a vehicle.
Yes.
Go around the streets and they talk. Yeah. People learn.
Yeah.
Now, with ITV doing their best, how many people have electricity at home to watch ITV?
So we can revert back to
to
that structure that you talked about.
The bad thing about government in Nigeria is that we do what Fela would call follow or copy. Anything we see in Europe, want to copy it. And we should limit going to our own level, the one we are used to. So that if we go back to MAMSA days, copy what MAMSA was doing, go around the town and announce. If you ask people now about quarantine, they don't know the difference between quarantine
isolation.
They don't. And the TV will be on. In my area, you don't get lights. And to even get water to bath is a different thing.
Okay, and now, let me just give kudos to my colleagues on Man Around Town. They've been going around to communities with a speaker on top of a car.
That is the thing.
Support them. Yes. Support
because this day I talked to
Yes.
My Igbo neighbors who occupied the whole of Mission Road and then Akwara in Benin, who are traders, they all sit there in front of their shops because they cannot see at home. They can't feed their family. They are sitting in front of their shops. So how will they hear anything as soon as light? So if you have that public address system going on,
all right, let's take this call. Hello, caller. Good morning. Tell us your name and where you're calling from. Please turn down the audio level on your television or radio.
Just calling from Isiolo.
Churchill is calling us from ECL. Go ahead.
Please, I want to make my own contribution. The NCDC, some people say they call the number, they don't pick, they said it. So I don't know. The government can still look at that. And we should also look at, I talked to the nurse in UDH. She told me that told me that I met her that the hospital is not to be ready, that if you're not having enough nose mask and the rest.
Okay.
So, additionally, we should be able to educate some of our masses about whether 1 meter is or 3 feet. Because for me, I think 1 meter is almost equivalent to the length of the cheetah. So some may not be able to know what 1 meter is or 3 feet.
Okay. Let me just advise that you stay tuned to ITV. We already have those numbers. On our scroll bar, you find the Edo State response team numbers.
They are local
on the scroll bar.
Yes.
If you watch closely now, and then where you have the isolation centers, the centers of Stella Obasanjo Hospital, everything, you have them on the scroll bar right now. So just take your bar on your paper so that you can put those things down.
I'm listening on radio, doctor.
Yeah.
I'm listening on radio.
Oh, you're listening on radio.
Okay.
That's a bit of a job. But before we cap it up, we'll read those numbers out for you. We'll read those numbers out before we conclude, okay?
Okay, thank you very
much. All right, thank you. Okay, we'll have our next caller. Hello, caller, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, please tell us your name and where you're calling from.
I'm coming.
Yes, you need to speak up so we can hear you, please.
Numbers. To assist in this kind of situation. And because you not put any people in the house without light, without problem. You understand?
Yes.
And secondly, it is also there to bring more awareness about how to go about it. Because if someone is in darkness, then it's not getting information. How can you do it forward?
Yeah.
So this should be, you know.
Okay, let me find out. Are you watching us on television or you're listening on radio?
I'm not watching television, but now I'm using it for myself.
Oh, okay.
I'm just using the radio now.
Okay. All right. Certainly, we'll read out the numbers. I'll read out the numbers so you can take them down and be able to hear. These are the numbers on the screen. The state EPID number, WHO.
Hello,
good morning.
Yes.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, tell us your name and where you're calling from.
My name is Anne from Okida.
Your name is who?
Anne from Okida.
Okay, Anne from Okida. Yes, go ahead and we can hear you loud and clear.
Okay, please, I want to find out if we can worship as this number is less than 20. According to one of your panelists, Mr. Sakoto said it is less than 20, no problem. So I have to go by that or by the current president's speech.
No, he didn't say if you are more than 20, there's no problem. He said.
He said
the CAN's chairman's instruction or order is based on the fact that if you allow 20, people can take advantage of that. He even cited the fact that last night some churches held all night with hundreds of people present, which is against the social distancing that has been advised to adhere to. So that's the challenge.
Another thing, sir, some of the girls from China, I would suggest that they have them through various tests before they start distributing us to the public.
I didn't get that.
The things that I said they imported from China, the keys, the face mask and all that.
Yes.
They should pass them tests before distributing them to the public.
Okay, that's an advice. That's an advice. That's a good one. That's a good one. Thank you.
Alright.
Okay. The numbers will read to you now, even though we have it on the scroll bar, just so you can help you take action. Hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name?
This is Bishop Issa from Sabogida Ora.
Bishop Issa, you're coming late today. What happened? I hope it's not coronavirus.
No.
It's not coronavirus.
As far as we are concerned, yeah. Okay.
Okay. Go ahead, Bishop Issa.
I have listened patiently to your message. You have spoken so well.
Thank you.
Now, the problem we have in Nigeria is the fact that we do not have reserves. We never save for the rainy day. Unlike America, Italy, and others, they have reserves. And the money they are using for their citizens right now is based on the reserve they have. Nigeria, what is their reserve? At the end of every month, governors go tap in hand, carry their bags, go to Abuja, collect money, and at the end of it all, the money is spent. There was a time when we have this oil green floor. Even the very minister for Putina has advised that let this money be kept in the reserve. The government took the government to pay, they wanted to do this, and the money was shared. So, this is my fear now is, we don't pray for those things to go into total lockdown. Because where are the people going to get food to eat? Where are they going to get money to buy food? As we are talking now, let us respect the let us be telling people, let us not deceive ourselves. Local government in aggressive, as we are talking, they have not been able to pay salaries. Some of them are even contemplating paying half salaries. And you want to tell these people that they should start sending money to individuals to buy food up?
Okay.
It cannot be possible.
All right.
So the only thing there is that we should pray that this thing should not end up here in a good day. Thank you,
thank you, Bishop Issa. We'll take our last call, and that will be it on the program. Hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name, and where are you calling from?
Yeah, good morning.
Please turn down the audio level. Turn it down. Okay, go ahead.
Okay. Now, yes. What I want to say is this. It's unfortunate that you are in a country where we live, where our politicians don't know how to take care of its citizens. The reverse is the case. That's why we are passing what we are passing through now. If we live here, they know how to take care of their citizens, then it will be easier. Anything that comes to people. That's just my contribution. Let's get to the point where people in authority know how to take care of their citizens. Once that is in, that is done, then you see things to be better. Thank you.
Okay. All right. We have some numbers we'll read to you now, just to help you make contact, and then
we're touching it.
Yes. Just ensure that you make the right contact, and then you assist. We already have some numbers on the screen, and then there's an emergency short code 112 you can also use. But in Edo South, is a toll-free number, and the number is 081-501-80091. And then in Edo North, you have 081-501-80093. Then in Edo Central, you have 081-501-80092. All these numbers are toll-free, which means when you call these numbers, you will not be charged for making such a call. So I'll go through the numbers again. If you have a Bible and a piece of paper, I'll read it for you. 081-501-80091. That's for Edo South. And then for Edo North, you have 081-501-80093. That's for Edo North. And then finally for Edo Central, we have 081-501-80092. And all of these numbers are toll free. And of course, you can also download Edo State Government EPMO app on Android for real-time COVID-19 updates, emergency contacts, test isolation centers, all in Edo State. And if you do all of this, you get information on real-time basis. Let me get the final word from Pastor Greg. What's the final word? Because this has to do with having everybody on the same page. If we must make progress, we must all be on the same page. So what are your final thoughts?
I think everybody should see it as his or her responsibility to actually educate other people, and then also to cooperate with the medical personnel and medical advice that has been given by the state government. If you are a church, social distancing, provide materials for washing of hands and other things, sanitizers also. And then the rich members or well-to-do members of the church, they should also be willing to help. And then the enlightened ones, enlighten the other people that are
on the light. Some churches have started giving palliatives to their members. Yes, comrade, in a minute.
Two quick things. Mm. It has been noticed that people for no reason have hiked up prices. We are not being fair to ourselves. I'll give you an example. When government said observe social distancing to some extent in buses and vehicles, there was complaint, and government stopped for 1 month the collection of taxes.
Yes.
What has been the response of transporters?
And it's a different thing they are talking about price.
Now. Yeah. Yeah. There's also a reduction in fuel price, however cosmetic it is, of about 20 naira and another 1 naira 50 kobo now.
Yes.
What has been the response of transporters? So it is huge. How? What happened to pure water, the sachet water, that it jumped from 10 naira to 20 naira? That a bag jumped from 150 to 250 and 300, now, even 350 in some cases. Mm. So we need to be our brother's keeper.
Okay.
If you are cashing in on this hard situation to oppress others and acquire money, be sure that COVID-19 does not respect faces. We don't know who it will catch. It may catch those who have stocked money at the expense of other people, and they will not be around to spend such money.
My last word on this is that I support all efforts of the government to reduce and eradicate this COVID-19. But government, please, your measures should have human face. Stay at home, it should have human face. Give us palliatives, those of us who are self-sustaining, so we can remain alive and not die.
Of the chief himself.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Commodore Sinosuke, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Barrister Greg Iyayi, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And Chief Ebi Thomas, thank you for coming. Well, that's our program today on Politics Today on Independent Television and Radio. We hope you enjoyed it while it lasted. Just in case you missed today's episode, you can go to our YouTube channel, www.youtube.com/ITV Radio NG, and watch the entire package. And please don't forget to subscribe and also share the video so that the points raised here can go viral and help people to take action to be safe and avoid catching COVID. Well, that's our program for today. Big thanks to all our crew members. My name is Sonny Duke Okosun. Thank you for staying with us. Have a great weekend. Bye for now.